Hey guys, welcome back from Classic Work. I put out there in the feelers the other day in the comments if y'all wanted me to do any machining videos versus how to set up tooling. I said I would. I had a couple people interested in it, so here we are today. I'm going to show y'all how to set up machine tooling more or less to do its job. Now, most of this equipment is very intimidating. If you've never fooled with it, there's a lot of knobs, there's a lot of levers, switches, indicators, needles, and stuff like that. And when I first got into this, I didn't even know how to turn these machines on. Very, very classic for somebody to look at this and be scared to death of it because they don't know what they're doing. They're actually very simple machines once you understand them. That's with anything, really. So the cool thing about these machines is they can hold very, very tight tolerances on things. Most people think when they look at a mill, oh, it can drill holes. It's a drill press. That's an insult to a mill. If he could yell at you, he would, or she. And it's the truth. They can do so many things. They can cut gears, they can cut slots, they can mill faces flat. Besides drilling holes, they can cut keyways, they can do all kinds of neat stuff. That's what a machine tool actually does. So I'm going to walk you all through the steps on how to set up these machines so they run properly. It's amazing. They're very, very sensitive to what goes on. If you bump them really hard, say if you run into the side of them on the forklift, like down on the base or something, that's enough to throw them out of adjustment. So you have to take your time in setting these up so they actually work good for you. If you're doing a lot of parts that require good tolerances, then you need to have your machine set up because all you're going to do is sit there and scrap parts more or less. So first thing you do when you get a mill especially is go ahead and try to level it the best you can. You'll set up a level right here on your table and just try to get it close in. Mills, they really don't have to be leveled. That's only for your benefit, more or less. If you're wanting to put a part in here and get it nice and flat, if your table here is nice and level, you can use a level for a measuring device, more or less. Bad thing about this mill is I got it used and the levelers are missing off of it, so we're not going to be able to level it more than how the floor is, so that's out the window pretty much. But everything else that we can do. Next thing we're going to do is tram the head in. Make sure that the head here is square with the table, and I'm going to show you how to do that, so let's take a look at it. The first thing that we're going to adjust is the sideways movement of the head here. There are two points of movement that you can do on a mill. There's tilt back and forth, and then you've got lateral, which is side to side. That's one thing that makes a vertical mill so universal is you can drill holes or mill slots at angles and compound angles and all kinds of good stuff. It's got a lot of degrees of movement. But most of the time when you do work, you want that spindle to be nice and square to the table. So in order to loosen the head, there's four bolts right here on the very front. I think these are 3/4 on most machines, or 19 millimeter. Yeah, that's what that is. And you'll loosen those up, you'll leave one of them tight, or fairly tight, snug. So we'll go ahead and loosen these up, wrench down. Oh, that nail's pretty tight. Let's see, we'll leave that one tight. Let's get this one. And one more. Hardly get that one good pull. Alright. Leave one of them semi-tight. Kind of snug them all back down. Okay. Now the head is relatively loose. Let's see if we can just break this one. There we go. That's all I want to go. All right, with one bolt holding it, you can adjust it without it falling on you. So for that, we're going to look to the side of the machine. Somebody's unboogered the zero up here. Most machines have some form of degrees on the side of the head that you can kind of look at them, and that's to roughly get it. So the next thing we got to do is put an indicator in the spindle and check our side-to-side movement. So let's take a look at that. Okay, we got an indicator set up here in the mill now. Now this is just an up-down indicator. that's going to tell us if our table's tilting or not. So we've gone ahead and loosened up the head.
It should be fairly loose. Got a little bit of tension in it.
Now then, we're going to check to see how much we're out. So I'm going to go ahead and zero the dial out. Now the trick to this is find an area of the table, like right here, on the very edge, that way that you can get two accurate readings on the same spot that are still parallel. So we're going to go over to the other side. Sorry, y'all can't see over there. Looks like we're about 18 thou out, so I'm going to zero this out so y'all can see it. When I go to the other side, it should read around 18. And there you go, 18 thou. Now, there's an adjustment screw on the side of the mill that you can loosen or tighten, and it will tilt the head. Now, when you get real close, when you get within a thou or two thou, you may want to use an adjustment hammer. Just hit on the side of the head of the mill here with a dead blow. Don't use a regular hammer, but just tap it. You shouldn't have to hit it very hard. So we're going to try to adjust it. And we want to be sure we're going the right direction, so we may be going the wrong direction here. And that's the wrong direction, so we need to loosen it. Because we want to go towards that zero. There we go. So we're going to go 10 thou, roughly. Go ahead and zero the dial out. We'll swing over. Okay, I may have went the wrong direction. Very possible. So I'm gonna swing back. Wow, looks like we didn't move at all. I know we went 10 thou. Okay. Let's try to go the other direction, because I think we just went the wrong way. Alright, so that's the way we want to go. So we're gonna go to the 40. There's 30. Alright, there's 40. Let me zero it out. Okay, swing over. And we're not even touching. Yeah, we went way over. So we went the wrong way. Okay, looking pretty good there. I think we're only out maybe, check to see, looks to be 4 thousandths. Okay, so I'm going to zero this out, and it should be 4 on y'all's side. There you go. Now, yeah, it's roughly 4. So I'm going to go just a little bit. Now, when you get this close, go in halves. Don't try to go full set. So we want that dial to move over there just 2 thousandths. There we go. Zero it out. We may have went the wrong direction. We'll check and see. Yes, we did. Okay, I went the wrong way. That's okay. It's good to have lots of patience with this, because it'll mess with you. Okay, so we're roughly, looks like 8 out. So we'll go back. Probably when I release the pressure. Yeah, I figured it was going to do that. Alright, so we got to crank back up to around 2. There we go. So zero out again. Okay, according to this, we're about 8 out again. So we're going to go the other way just a scotch. Whoops, that might have been too much. Let's try that.
about four out. So we're gonna go over four. Or two, really. There we go. We'll hit it just a little bit. Should be really close. Oh yeah, dead on. Dead on. That looks good. Alright, so zero over here. And zero right there. So now then we know that our side-to-side movement is good. So I'm gonna go ahead and snug these up here on the front. Then we got to take a look at our side-to-side movement. And after you tighten them up, double check it and be sure it's okay. Okay, now to adjust the head tilt right here, you've got three bolts that you can loosen up, and then your adjustment screw is up here. This is like a big worm gear. Actually, both of them are. The worm gear right here, and there's one right here that does the tilt. Now this one's a little bit trickier because the full weight of the head, that's the motor and everything, is sitting on that one. So once you loosen these up, like I said before, keep one of them tight. Preferably, I like to keep the bottom one tight, but that's just me. But loosen them up and then you'll do all your adjusting up here. So just be real wary of it because that thing likes to fall. Okay, we're all set up to check the tilt now. Now what I've done is I've taken a magic marker and I've put a nice 90 degree line on my table here. That way I've got the same point of measuring every time, so you go straight to that line. Now then, we're just going to check, see how far we're out. Go to the back of the line. And it looks like we're at about 17 thou. So we'll come back to zero over here. And we'll go ahead and try our luck, see which way we're going to go. Five thou. Let's go to 10. There's 10. We'll go over here and check. All right, we'll go to zero on this side. I think we went the wrong way. I'm gonna go just a little bit further just to double check it. Same direction. There's 90. Go to 95, go to zero. It's very misleading. It takes a lot of patience. I think we're going the right direction, so we're 10 thou out now. So let's keep going that direction. So we want to go to the 5 now. 5,000's on the positive side, so we'll go to 5. Okay, go to zero. Come back. Oh man, we're doing okay. So looks to be about 7 out. So we'll come back. I don't know why the numbers don't correspond right sometimes. It just depends. Some machines are a breeze, some of them are tough. Just the way it goes. So we'll go another 5 grand. Zero it out. Swing over. Looks like we're about 5.5 out, so we'll zero out this side this time and come back just to take a look at it. All right, so we're at 95. Let's keep going. Let's go to zero. There we go. Zero. Come to the other side. We're about 4 out, so let's keep going. We've got the 10 mark over here. Come back. Whoops. Alright. See, we're on the 10 there. I bet it's 0-0 now. There's 0. I'm hitting this little lip right here. Okay, looks like we're about... We're 4 out, but it's on the other side of the dial now. I may have went a little too far, so we're going to pull it back just a little bit. And see, I got to take the slack out of the screw now, so I got to readjust it. All right, I'm going to go right there, zero it out. Come back. It's just a tedious little process. It looks like we're about 2 thou out now. All right, I'm going to go just a little bit more and see what happens. We'll go about a thou. Getting really close now. Zero. Catch my indicator. Okay, I went the wrong way, if you notice that. All right, I'm going to go back. I got to take the slack out of the screw. Got to move this lamp. Go to the 9 mark, zero out, whoops, wrong way. Ooh, really, really close now, you see that? That's about a thou out. Okay, I'm going to pick the spindle up just a little bit. May not can. Nope, I ain't gonna be able to without the handle. Alright, that's a thou out. Let me check it again. Ooh, that's close. That is really close. And when you spin it, you'll notice it barely moves. Very, very little. That's what you want to see. So we'll go all the way around. Okay, I'm going to leave it right there. That's a thou out. Unless you're doing a super deep part, that should be sufficient. You always want to go for about a thou total. So, you notice we're pushing all the way around. We're nice. Dead set. The needle you see hitting is probably nicks in the actual table. So, there might be a hole there where a vise hit it or something like that, a little dent. That's what you want to see. Is that indicator barely moving? Very nice. There you go. That's good enough right there. And once you get done with that, you'll want to tighten your bolts up just like you did on your head and then recheck everything, make sure nothing moved. So there you go.
I tell you what, the weather will amaze you. It'll be 75 degrees here and then it'll be 40 degrees and raining. Anyways, one couple of things I wanted to point out real quick. If you notice, this indicator right here is only 3 inches away from the spindle. The longer that you have, the more accurate it's going to be. So, and there are actual tram bars that they actually make that you can position way out here and you'll get a much, much more accurate reading. But for what I do and for the majority of people out there, this right here will be good enough. So I just want to point that out. Another thing is when you tighten these bolts up here, just like you would on a tire on a car, you want to do opposites from each other when you tighten. That way you don't put the head in a bind. So, and don't over tighten them. Please, whatever you do, do not over tighten them. So just a few little things on that. I know somebody would point it out if I didn't. Alright, the last thing that we're going to do for the mill is actually put a vise on here. Now, the mill is pretty cool that it can use several different tooling operations more or less to make it more versatile. But the main thing that a mill does is hold what's known as a horizontal vise. And this one right here is a good illustration of that. Now this one right here, it is not a very good mill vise. It will not hold very, very tight tolerances, but it does real good for roughing apart, drilling a hole, something like that. It's a decent vise. It's not a good parallel vise, but for what we're demonstrating here, it's pretty good. So, first thing you do is clean the vise, if you hadn't already done so. And it's more important to clean the bottom than it is the top, because this right here is your reference surface. All this has been ground. This one hasn't. It's been mill cut, looks like. But most vices, most good quality vices, have been ground on the bottom, so they will hold very, very tight tolerances. So you do not want a chip to get up under there. So be sure you take your rag and go under there and clean those chips off of there and clean where you're going to put it as well. When you get done, take your bare hand and just wipe. I don't know how your hand can pick up so much more stuff than the rag can, but it can. Make sure that jerker's nice and clean. And if you have the option to have a stone, it's a good idea to stone it, and it'll get rid of any high spots. But we're not going to go into all that. Place the vise, slide it where you want it to go. Now I'm going to show you a trick to quick set up your vise so you don't have so much time indicated into the spindle. So let's take a look at it. Alright, here's the trick right here. If you look at these lugs right here, which actually hold itself to the base, or the base to the table, look at the chamfer right here. My old machinist instructor told me this, very good trick. You want to put the edge of that lug right there, right on the edge of that chamfer. And it may take an adjustment hammer and just bump it back and forth until you get it close. There we go, and you'll do the same thing on the other side. Get it close. I'm going to have to hit it just a little bit. There we go. Pretty close right there. And this side needs to go back just a little bit. But that'll get you so close. I've seen a lot of people struggle with that, trying to do that. So if you follow that guideline right there, that'll get you, that'll shave just tons of minutes off your setup process. Okay, now we can set up the vise. We've got it roughly on our chamfers, so all we'll have to do is take an adjustment hammer and kind of bump it around if we need to move it any, which we probably will. Now, next thing is you always indicate off the back jaw of your vise. You probably can tell from over there that this back jaw is kind of skin up and beat up. It's also got a V-groove cut in it. So if you got a vise that's all mangled up, you can take a parallel of some kind, this one here I made myself, and stick it in the jaws and clamp it, and that'll give you a good parallel surface to run your indicator on. And that'll help you out a bunch. So the next thing we'll do is we'll bring the table up, and we'll just run back and forth on our x-axis until we get where we need to go. So we'll go up, we'll bump the indicator about 15 thou, and then just run the x and see how much it's out. Alright, you see it going back and forth like that? My parallel's got a little bit of a bend in it, looks like. Okay. Right. Go right there, zero the indicator out. Go back. I don't pay no attention to that middle. Two ends is what we're concerned with. Wow, that looks like about half a thou out. Dang, that was lucky. Nope, wrong way. Right there. Yeah, preferably you want a good parallel to do this with. As long as your two ends match up together, there's the dip, it's going to come back. There you go, that's pretty good. Really good, matter of fact. So even with a bent parallel, you can get it fairly close. So let me get a little better shot. Right, let me just show you how close it's in. I'm gonna zero the indicator. There you go. Now we're on the left side, we're going to go to the right. Remember that my parallel's got a little warp to it. Coming back.
There you go, and that's all the way to the other edge. Now, it may be out more than that. I know that looks like dead nuts, but it probably is differed a little bit. But if you got a good vise or a good parallel or both, you wouldn't have this issue. That needle should just stay in one spot all the way across. But it just goes to show you can have some less than superior quality tooling and still be able to pull off precision work. So that vise is good and square. Okay, we're going to turn our attention to the lathe now. Now, the very first thing that you do to a lathe when you get one is level the bed. Now, I said on the mill earlier that it's not as critical, and that is true, but on a lathe, it's a lot more critical because on a mill, the table is supported by tons and tons of metal, so there's less chance of it flexing. On a lathe, if you notice, the bed here is hollow all the way underneath. Okay, and you're only supported by two points. You've got legs down here on this corner, and you've got legs on the opposite corner on that end. So that whole bed right there can flex. I know it don't look like it can flex, but it will. So you need to level that up as much as you can, or you will get little deviations in your work that you don't intend on. So real simple to do. If you see over there, I've got two levels over there. One of them I want to show you. Now, you can level a bed with just a standard old level. This is a torpedo level, but you could use a 3 foot or a 4 foot even. But these will get you close. They're not as accurate as you need them to be, but they will get you pretty close. This right here is a machinist level. Now, this joker right here is super duper accurate. You can see that bubble just whizzing past left and right. I can't hardly get a good bead on it because I'm too shaky. But super duper accurate. It'll get you within, some of them are as accurate enough to get you in within 1/1000ths and like 12 feet, something like that. Some of them are even better than that. But that's amazing. That is showing up amazing. So if you got a tool this fancy to use, I recommend you use it. And that's all we're going to do. We've got levelers on this one. There's some at the back feet here. Look at them. There's some at the back feet right here, and they got two on each side. I don't think there's any on this base. I'll double check again, but I don't think there's any on that one. So the only level that you can do is from the back, which is perfectly fine, but I'll double check again and be sure. Actually, there may be one under some of that crud, but anyways, I'm gonna get it cleaned up and take a look at it, and I'll show you what a leveled bed looks like. Turns out it does have levelers on that side of the lathe, so I'm on the back side trying to get it over. Pretty dang good, if I say so myself. Alright, we've done the headstock, now we're going to do the tailstock. Very nice. We'll go with that. Alright, that was the easy part. Okay, now that was the easy part. Now the hard part is going to be leveling it longitudinally, long ways. Now,
The biggest problem with this is we're going to have to come up the same rate on both. It's got to come up over here on the tailstock side, so that'll be the easy side. But they got to come up the exact same amount. So for every turn you put on one, you have to do the same amount on the other one. And according to my level here, we're off about an eighth of an inch. So it's going to be a lot of screwing, if you know what I mean. So anyways, going to continue with that. I'm going to have to get my other camera here out here in just a second. And it's going to be a little bit of a chore, but we're going to get it and bring it on up. And when we get done, we'll have to go back and check back towards the tailstock, make sure it's still square or level this way, because it may develop a little bit of a twist as we come up. So we'll take a look at it. Well, that took a lot longer than I thought it was going to. I got everything leveled within about probably 5 to 10 thou, so I'm gonna call that good enough. Oh man, it helps not to have a machine that's 70 years old to true up. All right, next thing. Now that we got everything nice and level on the bed, we're gonna turn our attention to tailstock. Tailstock is not centered with the chuck, so I'm gonna show y'all how to do that. There's a couple different ways you can do it. Like everything, you know, there's more than a thousand ways to skin a cat. So I'm gonna show you the way that I was more or less taught. So it seems to do the best, and if you ain't got a bunch of fancy equipment, then it's probably your best shot. So let's take a look at it. Okay, I'm gonna show you what we're gonna do to find our center on our tailstock now. Now this is the dirt cheap way, thrifty way to do it, but you can still get accurate measurement like this. What I've done is I've taken a piece of stock right here and I've turned a 30 degree taper on it, same as our tailstock over here, 60 degree included angle. And since I got it here in the three jaw, since I've turned it, doesn't matter if it's indicated or not. When you get down turning, it should be nice and true, which it is in this case. But we've got that, and really you need a faceplate with a lathe dog and all that good stuff with a dead center like a number three. I don't have any of that, that's why I'm doing it like this. Next thing you'll need is a piece of stock. Once again, if you have a lathe dog, use it. All I've done is I've welded a piece of scrap material to this piece of stock. So what we've got here is we'll put this in between the centers. We got a hole in each end. Nice and tight. This piece of stock right here will ride against this three jaw so it won't slip, just like a lathe dog does, and we should be good to go. And that's going to be our method for figuring out how bad our centers are off, more or less. So take a look at that. So what you'll do is you'll just take a little old skin pass, take 10 or 20 thou, something like that, and you'll check the difference, and we'll take a look at that and see how much we're actually out.
Alright, let's check our difference. Okay. Looks like we're at 675 plus 16. It's going to be 591. Let's check this in. Okay. I do not think that's right. It's dead on the money. Can't be right. That's a little more better. Okay. According to this, we're 5 out within 8 inches. I believe that's around 8 inches. So, this is the big side. Okay. So, this is the big side. So, we need to go, this end needs to come towards us. This side does. So, let's take a look at that to show. So, 6th out, that's not bad, actually. That was a lot better than I thought it was going to be. So, let's show what you're going to do. Okay, I'm going to show you the setup here. We got a dial indicator right here on the stock. That's going to tell us which way we're going in or out. And now, I don't know who did this, but we've got 2 studs here welded. Somebody's welded a nut on, and I've never seen anybody do that to a tailstock. That's definitely different. Most of them have Allen wrench, Allen cap screws, or I've even seen flathead. Well, I've never seen flathead on them, but they've got different things. Usually nothing like this. Somebody's cobbled this up. But the point I'm trying to get at here is use 2 wrenches. If you got to have 2 Allen wrenches, whatever it takes, use 2. That way you can loosen and tighten at the same time. Because if you try to do it one at a time, you'll get your adjustment out of whack. So much easier to do it with 2 wrenches. So I'm going to set up here on our dial indicator, and we'll go from there. All right, we got to make that needle move inward 3 grand. So let's see which way she's wanting to go. Loosen one side. Oop, wrong way. You go the other way. There we go. 3 grand. There we go. That's pretty close. That's like 2 3/4. So we're going to stop right there, and now we're going to make a pass. Be sure to tighten everything back up. That is actually not a bad finish for cold roll. Granted, it was with a piece of high-speed steel, which does good on cold roll, but it's also dull, so not too shabby. All right, let's check it again. See where we're at. Okay, looks like 572. Oh, no way. No way. Don't tell me we got it on the first hit. I don't believe that. 572. Look at that, guys. Probably can't see it in this light. Straight all the way across. I almost don't believe that. 72. Huh. Check the middle. Same thing. Man, I wonder if his mics are off. In a way, we did that in the first hit. Man. Never fooled tailstock that easy. Same thing. Same thing. Man, that was amazing. Huh. Wouldn't have guessed that. Well, I guess the next thing is we'll take a heavy cut, maybe 50, 60 thou. And, well, that's an average cut. That's a heavy cut with high-speed steel. And see if it holds true. It should. I don't know why it wouldn't. We'll give it a try and see how it looks. I can't believe that. just goes to show you, when you plan something to work, it works sometimes. Let's go, there's 40. Let's go 50 thou. Try that. That's negative brake on that tool, so it ought to be able to handle that. It'd help if it was in gear. Okay, we're going to test this one more time because I didn't believe my numbers last time. So let's see what we got here. Alright. Looks like 521. It's an inch and a half and 21 thousandths. This is 5 1/2 and 18 thousandths. Or three off there. Let's see what this edge here is. That's 21, huh? What's going on here? It's 19. Let's check our middle here. This is a thick part, so it shouldn't flex too much. That was 50 thou cut, though, so that was a good bit of cut. Might have had a little pressure on it, especially with that negative brake. Okay, that's 18 and a half. Okay, I think since out here on the end, we're at 21, and the majority of the shaft here is 18, looks like. We got some up and down, high and low going on. So we're going to adjust it again. This side is the big side. So we need to move once again towards the tool post. So we went 3/1000ths last time. We're going to go a lot smaller this time. We may not even make a thou. So let's try that. Same process as before. Two wrenches, dial indicator, and then we'll make a pass. I'm going to adjust the speed a little bit. I think that's some of the trouble we're having too. About half thou. Try again. Alright, let's see if we did any good this time. We should be right at an inch and a half now. My math is correct. Alright, looks like we're at 5'10". Yeah, it's all good. Let's see what the middle is. 5'10 1/2", looking good. Ooh, must have went the wrong way. 5'13". So we've got a progression this time. I think the speed did help this time. So we've got a difference between, looks like, right here. Okay, 5, that's 10.5 really. 5'10". And, okay, 5'10 and 5'13, so we got a 3 thou gain. So this end's the fat end now. So, okay, we went too far in. We got to go back just a little bit. So I think I moved it too much coming back. So we need to go back this way about 1.5 thou. So may have to get out my real good dial indicator to get that on. Well, we're going to try it again, one more time. Tell you gotta respect the old timers. This is cold rolled steel. Anybody who's machined anything for any period of time will tell you this stuff takes finish like a turd. It is awful. And this tool right here came with this lathe, and all I did was just clean it up a little bit. And whoever ground that knew exactly what they were doing. Kind of like a fingernail grind, but that is a beautiful finish. Well, I'll be able to check that very easily. And that joker is smooth as it can be, no chatter. I didn't hit it with no sandpaper. I mean, that's straight off the machine here. And good chip control. They got a little long, but that's about average, about 4 or 5 inch curl. And every one of them was like that, and there's a little long. But that's amazing. Cross your fingers and hope this is the last pass, because it looks good. Alright, let's see where we're at. Okay, we're at 460. I'm gonna call that good enough. Check that side again. 461, okay. Yeah, I believe we're in good shape. Check this side one more time. That's a little tight. 460. Yeah, that's good enough for me. And 8 inches, about 1/2 thou out. I don't think we can complain with that. All right, let's take a look at our handiwork and see how good we did. Now, you probably noticed right off the bat that this is crooked, and it is. It's probably 30 thou out. And the reason was I didn't realize that there was a tack on the end of this piece right here that pushed it off the edge of the vise. So I recut one on the other side. Nothing changed, and I'll show you how well it turned out. Let's take a look at this holder first. I've got a center punch pin here. Place it in. Got a nice machine of square here. Let's see if I can get all this just right. Pretty good. There's a little deviation there towards the bottom. I think there was a chip under this, to be honest, but that is pretty slick. There we go, if you can get a little better angle on it. But much more precise than you could do ever with the drill press. And that's a deep hole. I think this material is 2 inches thick. Check it and see. It's 1.5 inches thick. Yeah, so good stuff. As far as the slot here, we can measure either side, doesn't matter. Right here we're at, looks like 840 thou. Let's see if I can show you all this. 840, I was probably showing 41 for y'all. I probably moved a little bit. We'll check this side. Probably 41 again because I moved. There you go. And just as equal on this side. Since that was an end mill, it was very true. 270. 268. Might be a little deviation there. But it's all really, really close. And that's with a totally wore out vise. So if you had a good vise, you could see that how it would be much, much better. So it's always good to see how your stuff turns out to make sure that, you know, you just can't go by numbers sometimes. Sometimes you just have to do the work in order to test it out. One other thing I just wanted to point out real quick is when you get everything right on a machine that's feed rate or surface speed, spindle speed, your tool geometry right, you get what's known as a gorgeous finish. And here's the trick to knowing when you've made it, is listen. There's like little tiny little grooves that are in this metal. And my finger rubbing up and down them is kind of like a, what is it, like a washboard, more or less. And it's just like a micro washboard. That's no sandpaper. You can't do that with sandpaper. Only a machine can do that. I don't know. I was real impressed by that. Made me feel good. Well, guys, I know it was a lot more technical this go around. We had a lot more dial indicators and cutting oil and coolant and chips flying everywhere and whatnot. But these are good techniques to learn, especially if you're trying to get some old machine tools running again. And the concept applies for them all. Doesn't matter if they're brand new or if they're old like this machine or really old like my lathe. So it's all universal pretty much. Once again, guys, hope you enjoyed it. Hope you got something out of it. Please like, subscribe to me if you hadn't already. And guys, I will see y'all next time. Y'all take care from Classic Work.